Amen. Good morning. I said good morning.
Good morning.
Amen. Isn't God good? All the time. Amen. It's a very special Sunday morning. In a few moments, we'll be taking our, we'll be participating with the Lord's table. But before we do that, we'll be, today's first Sunday of the month, it's always the Communion and Mission Sunday. So we'll be giving you the privilege to give your tithes and offering in a few moments. And while you're preparing, just a reminder, this coming Sunday is actually Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday, yeah. And then we'll have Good Friday. Good Friday celebration at 7 p.m. And then after that, Resurrection Sunday at 6 a.m. in the morning. 6 a.m. in the morning. That is Sunday. And so we won't have any evening celebration. Instead, we will have a 6 a.m. Easter celebration. And then after that, we'll have, as always, we will have breakfast fiesta. Amen. And come hungry. That Sunday morning, come hungry, but bring some pot faith. Amen. All right, let's all stand and give our offering to the Lord this morning. Lord, again, we thank you so much. The privilege to return back what belongs to you, the tithes belongs to you, God. We thank you, the privilege that you want us to be faithful stewards, to move into the realm of the impossible and to bring your word to a lost generation. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone will say, amen. As always, please come. If you have any prayer need, just come and give your tithes and offering to the Lord.
I cannot feel your love so strong and still from where I've hid. I cannot hear your voice above my will, but still you listen. And all the while you call me to your grace, all that I one day face, lead me to the end of myself.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. Would you agree with us and extend your hands that God would, for the prayers? Lord, again, we thank you for your children. We have found the ministry or the blessings to give, and that is to give your tithes and offering. I ask you now, Lord, that you will open up the windows of heaven, pour out your blessings upon your children, rooms of opportunities and promotions, health and healing be upon them. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone will say amen and amen. You may be seated. God bless you. Amen. Again, we welcome those that are here for the first time, and thank you so much for considering us this morning. And if you are looking for a home church, we are available. And at the same time, we have so many friends, pastors and leaders, and we know the churches around the island. And so if you have any questions, let me know, and we can direct you to a church that will benefit you. However, you are welcome to be part of this celebration. Can you give God glory for the first-timers? Amen. Amen. Well, today I like just to consider the word this morning. Most of the time when we go to church and we want, what can I receive? Is that correct? What can I receive or what can I benefit from? And that is rightly so, and that is good to get something to benefit from. Sometimes what we tend to forget is that the love that we have is still a self-love. What I mean by that is that, for example, in terms of God, it says, well, I love God because he meets my need. I love my spouse because he meets my need. And so that's still, even though it's love, it's still for my sake. And sometimes when we go to church, when we're going through difficulties, we might not have that sense of openness because we are going through the valley. So this morning, I'm not going to preach about what can we benefit from God. I just want to give this message before we partake of the celebration, is that there's only one name that is above all names, and that his name is Jesus Christ. What I'd like for us to do is to reorient ourselves into that famous name that is above all name, and that name is Jesus Christ. What I'd like for us to consider is this: in any situation, there's only one that will remain faithful, and his name is Jesus Christ. We don't come to Jesus Christ when we have a need. We come to Jesus Christ because of who he is and what he have done. And so when we begin, amen, when we reorient ourselves into the fact that whether we love him or not, he will still continue to love us. Whether we're happy or not, he still continue to provide for us. When we know the centrality of the Word of God, the center of the Bible, it is Jesus Christ himself. When we begin to understand that the focal point of salvation is God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, then we begin to settle down that the world is not about us, it is about the name that is above all name, and his name is Jesus Christ. That is amazing. When we begin to understand that the world is created for him, he created it for himself. When we begin to understand that he's the one that we can depend on, it is not about us, it is about Jesus Christ. We are a product of his love. When we begin to settle in that dimension that God loves us and Jesus Christ, God's Son, God himself, when we begin to understand that relationship, whatever happened in our lives, we know that Jesus Christ remains the same yesterday, today, and forever. And hopefully that will settle the issue about what it is about the Word itself. It is about Jesus Christ. So I'd like to, the title of the message this morning, Jesus Has No Equal. Wow. Jesus has no equal. Can somebody say amen? Can we repeat that? Jesus has no equal. In the amount of time that I have, I'll try to say something that will hopefully entice you more to seek God, to seek him more, because you will find out later on, there is no one, there is nothing, there is no person that he will equal, that a name that is above all name. And when you are in difficulty and when you are a problem, when you call upon the name of the Lord, amen, Jesus, you will find out there is no equal. As I mentioned earlier, that we'll try to go to the Hebrews, because Hebrews, if you begin to understand it, they were Christians that started well, and they began to question because they were being persecuted, their dreams weren't being fulfilled, and they began to be in a drifting manner. And you will find out later on that there are many people just like that, because they received the Lord because God provided something for them, which is still self-love. And when they feel God is not answering their dreams and desires on their timeline, God says, God, why? When in fact, God is always in control. And so the writer says, I again like for you to be reminded. Here in Jesus Has No Equal, it is found in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 through 3. What we like to do is that if you have your Bibles with you, what I like for us to understand, because we're going to take the points here, because you will find out that Jesus has no equal, no one. And it is my prayer that when you leave this place, you will stand strong that Jesus Christ, you will never find anyone that will equal the name that is above all name, which is Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, he goes here. It says, on the New King James Version says, God who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets, and in other translations as visions and dreams, and as in this last day spoken to us by his Son. Say that with me, please. His Son. Say that with me. His Son, whom he had appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. who being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sin, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Now, in another translation, let me just give to you what that means. God himself, it says here, the writer was trying to give him back. Look, this is how it started. In a very three verses, he actually expounded who God used and uses to talk to each one of us. Now, in the Living Translation, it's in our dialect. Look at this. It says, long ago, God spoke in many different ways to our fathers through the prophets, in visions and dreams, and even face to face, telling them little by little about his plans. But now, say that with me, now, in these days, he has spoken to us through his Son, to whom he has given everything, say everything, through whom he made the world and everything there is. God's Son, Jesus Christ, shines out with God's glory, and all that God's Son is and does marks him as God. He regulates the universe by the mighty power of his command. He is the one who died to cleanse us and clear our record of all sin, and then sat down in the highest honor beside the great God of heaven. Jesus Christ himself, he's the center of the universe, center of our life. He must be, whether we like it or not, he's the one that will be coming back again. I'd like to make this point for a second. On the first verse, if you would notice, a long time ago, he said, spoke in many different ways. Just take a note of that, saying, oh, we serve a God that is not a silent God. We serve a God that is not silent. Someone say amen. What happened is this, when we go through difficulties and when you go through valleys, for some reason, the voice of God is not heard. And they would say, Lord, why are you silent? The writer says, look at this, says, God in the past has spoken to the prophets, to dreams, visions. He's always continually relays messages to each one of us to remind us, although we may not hear his voice, he's not silent. But instead, he's always projecting his will through nature. When you go to the nature, you can see that somebody, someone created this. One time I was speaking to a Christian, says, hey, you know, hey, you haven't seen in church. Well, you know what? It's been a while since I heard God. I don't seem to hear anymore. I said, when was the last time you read your word? See, the word of God is powerful. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says this, that it is alive, it is powerful. I said, if you don't hear God through nature, if you don't hear God through anything around you, absolutely, when you open your word, God will certainly talk to you. So when you say, when you're going through difficulties, I don't hear God, chances are, you haven't opened his word. As soon as you open his word, then you begin to understand, he continues to talk to each one of us. Why that is important. When I feel like as if when I am sensing that God's like as if he's far away, I would go to the Word, and most of the time, and maybe you have a way of doing it, but I would go to the Psalms of David or Psalms. I would try to generate an inner energy through the Word of God. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. I would go, and then you begin to see that God is not silent, but through his word, he will begin to put this energy in your heart that God is alive. And when you begin to read his word, it will jump up, bless the Lord, O my soul. And then pretty quick, you will realize that it's not God's fault that he's not talking, but most of the time, it is our ear and our heart that has become dull of hearing. And sometimes I ask you, I would challenge you, whether you're here for a word and you may not hear God today, I ask you that you will go home, open your word. If God doesn't speak through his word, start with Psalms, start with Proverbs, and you will realize as soon as you begin to be immersed in His Word that is alive, that is sharper than any double-edged sword, it will come in, it will penetrate, it will divide, it will make you, it will become a witness. And before you know it, God has not remained silent, but instead, He's always there because He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? So the first point I want to bring with you, number one, is this. It has to do with relationship with creation, relationship with man, and relation with God. Number one is this. When verse 2, look at your word with you, stand with me on verse 2, it says here that He has created everything in the world. He's the creator of all things, number one. Now, if you don't mind, please, on this one here, if you can, He has appointed all things through whom He made the world. Underline that word, He made the worlds. Underline it, and then put like a line going from there and put number one. Point number one is this, so that you will never, I know some of you may, you know, you can remember things, but if you write it down, it will be something that you, okay, so on that line, number one, line it and put, He is the creator of the world. Number one, He is the creator of the world. He's the creator of the world. The point that I like to do is this, that, and here's what it is. For by Him, Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 and 17, it says here, for by Him, who is He talking about? Jesus. Say that with me, Jesus. For by Him, all things were created that are in heaven and the earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or power, all things were created by Jesus, by Him and for Him, and He's before all things, and in Him things consist. His name is Jesus Christ. John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And in the beginning, He was with God. In the beginning, Jesus Christ, who is God Himself. Now remember this. Jesus Christ wasn't born 2,000 years ago in Bethlehem. That was His incarnation, but He was already with them, God Himself, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And one of the things I'd like for us to consider is this. Christmas is not Christ's birth. He wasn't born. He was already there. But He was virgin birth so that He become just like the fulfillment. For God so loved the world that He gave. Jesus Christ is the Word. Amen. The word there, let me go back there and project it. The world, in the Greek world, it says aionos or eons or ages. It has to do with space, time, and matter. Space, time, and matter. He created the known world. Now, I'd like you to watch a video, and I know you love videos, and I can't explain it, but it's about 2 minutes and 2 hours. 2 minutes and 2 hours, depending on how fast we are. I'd like for us to consider this because I've shared it in my Facebook, and if you have it, I already know it, but if not, then here's the one. About apologists that talk about the beginning of God. Listen to this and watch it, please. Won't take long.
I am confused. Being philosophically consistent and being a very honest person, I'm sure you can tell me where God came from. And in addition, once you've told me where God comes from, please try to clarify how you can figure that a spiritual force can have an impact on a material universe to create it.
You got 5 minutes. Now, I just want to know which question.
That's all right. You may take the rest of the minute.
We're supposed to do one question at a time. Which one would you like? That was part of the format for the debate. So which question?
I want you to fill in the story of the rest of the beginning of the universe. God, spiritual matter, impact on material matter.
Okay. So two questions. All right.
Go ahead.
All right, your question, where did God come from, assumes that you're thinking of the wrong, obviously it displays that you're thinking of the wrong God, because the God of the Bible is not affected by time, space, or matter. If he's affected by time, space, or matter, he's not God. Time, space, and matter is what we call a continuum. All of them have to come into existence at the same instant, because if there were matter but no space, where would you put it? If there were matter and space but no time, when would you put it? You cannot have time, space, or matter independently. They have to come into existence simultaneously. The Bible answers that in 10 words. In the beginning, there's time. God created the heaven, there's space, and the earth. There's matter. So you have time, space, matter created, a trinity of trinities there. Just, you know, time is past, present, future. Space has length, width, height. Matter has solid, liquid, gas. You have a trinity of trinities created instantaneously, and the God who created them has to be outside of them. If he's limited by time, he's not God. The guy who created this computer is not in the computer. He's not running around in there changing the numbers on the screen, okay? The God who created this universe is outside of the universe. He's above it, beyond it, in it, through it. He's unaffected by it. So for, and the concept that a spiritual force cannot have any effect on a material body, well then I guess you'd have to explain to me things like emotions and love and hatred and envy and jealousy and rationality. I mean, if your brain is just a random collection of chemicals that formed by chance over billions of years, how on earth can you trust your own reasoning processes and the thoughts that you think? Okay, so your question, where did God come from, is assuming a limited God. And that's your problem. The God that I worship is not limited by time, space, or matter. If I could fit the infinite God in my 3-pound brain, he would not be worth worshiping, that's for certain. So that's the God that I worship. Thank you.
The God that we serve created time, space, and matter, and he's beyond, meaning he's not control. He's not cocooned in what we think. And our God, he's the created, Jesus Christ created all things. Point number one, all right? So point number two is this. It says, whom he has appointed heir of all things. Jesus Christ, number one, he created all things. Number two, he's heir of all things. He's the one. All of us are joint heirs, but Jesus Christ is the center, is the central figure in all Bible. One of these days, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And number three is this. I like this for us to consider. He says here, whom he has appointed heir. And on verse 3 says, and he is upholding all things by the word of his power. Upholding. Upholding simply means that he's maintaining, supporting, defending, and protecting. Upholding simply means that something in the universe is holding what it is where it is now. It is now. He's upholding the universe, created universe. Now I see your faces. No, some, well, you know, it's nature. It's random act of evolution. And I'd like to give you this illustration, if you don't mind. I'd like to get this good-looking guys. Come up here, guys. Come up. Can we give you a hand, please? All right, you too, yeah. All right, he's shaking his head, oh no. Okay, never give up, come on. All right, I'd like to give you this illustration and hopefully you can see where I'm going about the creation of God and upholding. Aren't they good looking? All right, the military says, attention. Come on, man, attention. Isn't it good looking? Chest out. Yeah. All right. You'll be the sun. All right. Ten hut. Okay. You'll be the earth. Ten hut. Okay. You'll be the moon. Good-looking one. You think we didn't see your smile, huh? You'll be the atmosphere. All right. Come up here. All right. This represents a little bit of what I mean about upholding what God has created. We call it sometimes nature. How many of you know the distance from the earth to the sun is? How many? Yeah, 93 million miles. 93 million miles from the earth to the sun. And they are there's a, the next one is which one? Mercury or Venus? Mars, Mercury, Venus, Earth, MVMJ, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and then good old Pluto, MVMJ, Sun, P. That's how I memorize them. So this one is 93 million miles. To be exact, it is actually 92,960,000 miles. The Earth, the surface of the moon, the sun. Can somebody guess the surface temperature of the sun is? Well, I'll guess. 12,000 degrees Fahrenheit. That's hot. Boiling point is what? For the Earth, 212 degrees Fahrenheit, right? Isn't it? Distance, 93 million miles. Exactly. How many of you know the distance of the moon to the Earth? Man, we have some good stuff here. 238,000 miles. 238,000 miles compared to that. Your moon. Okay. And then the atmosphere is the one that is encircling. But you notice the Earth is tilted about 23 exact degrees. Right? Thus, the moon rotates around the Earth. The Earth revolves around the sun. That gives us winter, spring, summer, or fall, the four seasons. In Guam, we have four seasons. Rainy, more rainy, sun, more sunny. That's what we have. We're on the equator. It's tilted, and people say, and try to say, well, why is it tilted? Because if the Earth is straight, guess what? The polar cap will encapsulate the Earth. Tilted so that there's a time for it. Winter, spring, summer, or fall. All you got to do is call. And God will be there. Yeah. I'm serious. This is true. If the sun goes in closer, or the Earth, whichever, the Earth will freeze. If the sun goes closer, we will burn. If the sun is further, we will freeze. If the moon is not the way tilted as it rotates, come on, look around. As it goes around the Earth, as it is, it has to do with waves, and you have the tides, low tides. Fisherman knows this. If it is not tilted, the Earth will be submerged in water twice a day. Now, your atmosphere is showing. Okay, now you go there. The atmosphere is here. You are the one. They talk about the first and the last protection of the Earth. Who created the atmosphere? All the meteors that we see that are bursting to destroy the Earth, they burn like streak in the air, and what do we do? We wish upon a star, right? When you see a streaking light, oh, you wish. But in fact, this guy here, the atmosphere, is actually protecting the Earth from all the destructive meteors and all the other particles that would go in. And God is saying to each one of us, who is doing that? Isn't it the God that created you and me at the exact position? Who maintains the season in and out, protecting us? An exact 23 degrees from the sun keeps us the four season, and people will say it's a random act of nature. Can I see a watch? I don't have a watch. I ran out of battery. Sister Keisha, this watch here, Can I have your dismissal, please? I will show you a miracle. They're mothers, and so you have nothing. Tell me, when should I like to have a Rolex. Come on now. How many of you believe in a mile, 2 seconds, 2 minutes, I will have a Rolex watch? Come on. How many hours do I need to do this so that it'll be as a random act? These two watches will turn into a Rolex watch. Patrick, come on now, son. You're a science major. I know you always have a straight C in math. How many times do I need to push like this so that this will become a Rolex watch? You will say, Pastor, you're crazy. Yes, I'm crazy. But many people tells us that by the random act of evolution or random act of nature, the world became as it is now. And something somehow is maintained by someone that they cannot tell who, but we know who. Because the Word of God says He's upholding. Come on now. Can somebody give me a reason not to worship God? He says He's upholding. Gravity is there for what purpose? So that you and I will be what? Cemented in this earth. If there's no gravity, we'll be flying like crazy. But for some reason, it says gravity is supposed to take a metal to metal so that it becomes what? A glued in. But it's not. It is something that God has created, not guess. That is the reason why when you see and hear the name of Jesus Christ, there should be something, because it says here, He's the heir of all things. He made by the voice, and He's upholding you. He's upholding the earth, and it's in time it will be destroyed and will be there. But in the meantime, there's no such thing as an accident creation by God. You have been created by God with a purpose. Every cell that you have, every number of your hair. Can somebody tell me, why would we doubt Jesus Christ who gave His life for us? And as if we approach God, when we say, God, would you please meet my needs? When in fact, even before we were here, He was already here. And we are just part of His creation so that He can prove who He is. The next one, it says here, He's the brightness. Okay, please. Thank you so much. That is just one point. What I meant by that is this. Thank you. God bless you. Great job, son. Son. He's the brightness of His glory. The moon doesn't have its own light, a reflection of the sun. Isn't it? Isn't it? Us, we don't have our own glory. We reflect what Jesus Christ is reflecting us. Jesus Christ is the eternal. He's the one whose glory manifests. He is not bound by our emotion. He is God Himself. You and I may be bound by our emotion in season, but Jesus Christ, may I say this to you, He is the brightness of His glory. Number four, He is the express image of His person. When you see Jesus Christ, you see God. When you hear the name of Jesus Christ, He's expressed. It means that it was the imprint. When you see a son, you saw that's a son. Jesus Christ is the imprint, the human representation, the perfect representation of God the Father, so that we can see. John the Baptist, behold, the Lamb of God is coming. He saw Him, we know by His name, Jesus. But that is not His name alone. He's the rose of Sharon, the lily of the valleys, the bright and morning star. He's the great physician. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the bright, the first and the last. We know Him by name. If we don't know, if we don't respect the name that is, we can actually understand Jesus, how can we know? How can we understand the very nature of God Himself? Jesus, there's no equal. Amen. Jesus is the imprint, the perfect image of God by the Word. And number five is this: He is our Redeemer as He purged our sins. He gave us. He died for our sins. He died for our sins. And the last one: He's the ruler of the universe. Look at that. He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. You know what that means? Pastor Rachel mentioned about the tabernacle and the Holy of Holies and Holy of Holies and the most holy place. What that simply means is that in those, if you have the time, there's no other than the mercy seat. Every day, every year, the high priest will come to take care of all the things that is there, but he never sits down. Even in the temple that was done 46 years, the temple, the priests do not have any where he can sit down inside the temple. Listen to me very carefully, it's very important. Because when Jesus Christ, he says this, he purged our sins and sat down. He sat down at the right hand of the Father. You know what that means? It is complete. All the priests before the covenant, they do not sit down because they know tomorrow they will do it again. They would do it again over and over. It is not complete. It is not perfect. But when the Son of Man came, amen, when he went, and then he actually gave his life, purged our sin. What did he do? And he sat at the right hand of the Father. You know what that means? Whatever he has done, whatever he has committed, whatever, it is the finality. There's no more addition. There's nothing left to do. And he says, it is complete, it is finished. When Jesus Christ died at the cross, amen, it is once and for all committed that he himself, no more, no less, no good works. It is not salvation plus good work. It is always by grace that you are saved. When Jesus Christ says, okay, anything else that I need to do, and he sat down, meaning is this: what I have done for the world, for you and I, it is complete, no more addition that you can do, that you can earn your salvation. All you need to believe is this: believe that the sufficiency of what Jesus Christ has done is more than enough to pay and to give us redemption through the blood of Jesus Christ. My friend, this is where we have come now. This is why you and I need to understand. The presentation took 2,000 years ago. It is what Christ has done for you and us. It is not what we can get, but what we can worship Him. When you begin to understand that you come to Jesus Christ to worship Him, not what you can get, because He knows already, your heart, your prayer will change. Because until such time as your prayer is what God can do for me, is still a self-love. What you need to do is this: Lord, I worship you because of what you have done. Jesus Christ is the name above all names. This video, last one, is this. We've seen it before, but I want you, before we partake, and listen to the word of this pastor.
The Bible says, my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impossible. impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's a key to knowledge. He's a wellspring of wisdom. He's a doorway of deliverance. He's a pathway of peace. He's a roadway of righteousness. He's a highway of holiness. He's a gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. I wish I could describe him to you. He's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. Well, you can't get him out of your mind. You see, you can't get him off of your head. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him.
That, my friend, is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. That is your king. That's my king. He loves us. If it doesn't excite you that we serve a God, Jesus Christ himself has died for us. Nothing in this world will ever, ever excite you. Let us pray. Lord, again, we thank you this morning, the privilege to come before you. Jesus, the center of the universe, Jesus, a Savior. Help us, oh God, be drawn closer to you. While every heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and for those that were selected for those who will be assisting, would you please come? While every heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you have never received Christ as your Savior, I ask you, would you consider giving him a chance, giving him what he has done? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever will believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The requirement is that you will believe and understand that what Jesus Christ has done is sufficient. What he has done at Calvary is the answer to the forgiveness of our sins. To repent, to turn away, to receive Jesus Christ, finished work at Calvary, to believe that he is God himself who died for us. Would you pray this prayer? Father, I confess that I'm a sinner, guilty of separation from you. But now I understand that Jesus Christ, God himself, died for me to fulfill his promise for my redemption. And at Calvary, he took my place His blood was shed for my sins. I believe with the shedding of the blood, my sins are forgiven. I believe Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God. So I receive Jesus Christ as my Savior and my Lord. Thank you for the forgiveness of my sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we thank you for the emblems of the bread representing the broken body of Jesus Christ and the fruit of the vine representing the shed blood of Jesus Christ. May we commit to you, to love you, to serve you, and thank you as we remember what you have done, Jesus, 2,000 years ago. Until you come, you commanded us to do it. For one of these days, you will return back for your church.
You glory.
Shall we all stand, please? Has everyone been served? Did we miss anyone? Everyone have their emblems? Amen. Let us pray. Father, again, we thank you. Your great love for us. Not only you spoke it, but you showed it. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. The blood of the Lamb continually cannot pay back the ultimate price. But when Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, came, His blood was shed for each one of us. His body was broken. The night He was to be betrayed, Jesus Christ took a piece of bread. He blessed it, broke it, and gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, let us all partake of the emblem of the bread, representing the broken body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And after we reached the same matter, our Savior took a cup. He blessed it and gave it to His disciples, said, "Take, drink. This is the blood of the new covenant, the blood that will be shed for you and for all men, so that their sins will be forgiven, cleansed, purged. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that the perfect Lamb of God has come. 2,000 years ago, His blood was shed once and for all for the sin of man. And thank you for the privilege by grace that we can live a life without condemnation because of what Jesus Christ has done. Thank you. And as we remember His death on the cross, thank you so much, God, for your love. In Jesus' name. Would you just lift up your hands toward heaven and in your way just acknowledge. Thank you, Lord. Thank you so much, oh God. Father God, we thank you this morning and again as part of your church spread out to all the world, an emblem that we continually do until you come. Thank you so much, oh God, that in the world we might have problems and difficulties, but you will never be a silent God, but instead you will always be with us. You will never leave us nor forsake us. And as we confess that Christ has died, that Christ has risen, that Christ is coming back again. We commit everything to you, our lives. Help us to live for you. Help us, oh God, to be mindful of our time. Teach us to number our days so we can gain wisdom. Help us, oh God, to represent you as we reflect your glory in this fallen world. May they will know you as well as the Son of God who takes away the sins of the world. We bless you. We give you all the honor. In Jesus' matchless name we pray. And everyone will say, amen. Amen. Would you put your hands together and give God the glory? Amen and amen. Amen. Before you're seated, give somebody a high five and tell them God is awesome.